So good morning everybody, I am here back with the next module of coursework, that is module 5, and I have actually included module 6 as well in the same context because they are so interlinked with each other. So I thought that you know it will be better to actually study both of them together. So this module is related to industrial scale production, quantification and calculations, as well as downstream processing. So I will proceed with the first one, which is module 5, industrial scale production of proteins. So you know this particular picture, as you can see, you know there are some large number of plants and controllers and a person working somewhere there and trying to do something, and these barrel shaped you know stainless steel compartments are the one in which proteins are being produced in industrial scale. Rather, I would say one step before that, that is the organisms or the bacteria or yeast or something or animal cell from which these proteins are supposed to be produced are being grown in these large containers in an industrial setup. So if we proceed further, we will understand what are the points to consider for any kind of industrial scale preparation of proteins. So as you know, in the laboratory scale, we have these flasks in which we put some medium. Medium means a culture or a food material in which the bacteria or the organism from which you expect to isolate the protein is being grown. Or if you go to the industrial scale, you cannot simply have this 1 liter, 2 liter amount of bacteria or culture grown, and from which if you extract proteins, it will be just few milligrams. So what people do is they generally go for bulk purchase of chemicals and other raw materials in huge quantities, and that brings down the cost as well as the cost of material, and the labor cost also decreases sharply when you increase the production. But for increasing the production, what you need to do is go to something called a fermenter, where the vessel size simply increases from 1 or 2 liters to let us say 5 to 10 liters. But these are also like the pilot scale preparation of the cultures from which the protein is finally going to be isolated, and a lot of you know adjustment and calculations and backhand you know anticipations goes on depending on how it grows from this flask level to this fermenter level, and finally when all the parameters are set by multiple trial and error and you know algorithms available that is how much of air should be there, what should be the pH for ideal growth of the organism. So it's important, because if the organism from which the protein is going to be synthesized grows well, then the protein also produced by these organisms is going to be very high you know amount. So all these you know technical setup goes on in this pilot scale of preparation, which goes from let us say 5 liters to 20 liters, and then if you need industrial scale production, then these are the kind of fermenters. So these are still you know smaller fermenters, which is about let us say you know 500 liters or 1000 liters production capacity. But then there are so large pharmaceutical companies actually have these kinds of huge vessels with multiple probes, something maintaining the pH, something the aeration, some other you know probe maintaining the aeration, some other actually removing the entire culture so that it is well aerated and is going around in all corners of the vessel. So all those parameters are maintained. There is a feed of the culture which continuously keeps on giving or providing food supplements to the growing organisms, and all those parameters are maintained through some modules. So these are like you know some big industrial scale production units, but then even bigger production units are there in the world which I am not showing pictures of. But then what happens is the materials used in such kind of huge production units of proteins should be inert, resistant to corrosion, and mostly they are made up of stainless steel, unlike the glass you know containers that is there. So you know in glass they can break, there can be corrosions, there can be other you know chemical related you know corrosions, etc. So because if suppose this organism produces a lot of acid or a lot of alkali or something else. I do not know what else it does produce, because it all depends upon the organism that is growing. So they can be corrosive, there can be leakage, there can be breakage. So to avoid all of those, stainless steel containers like the ones shown here are used. And they should not be leaching toxic material. So these material are made up of stainless steel, they need not have to, they should not leach. And you know, not only this production, what happens is whenever a certain component, a protein produced from these big laboratories are going to be going to the market, then the market or the manufacturing, good manufacturing practices are to be involved for all kinds of approvals. So, because these proteins are either going to be injected or going to be used in some other industry or is going to be used as a food supplement and all of those, they undergo tight regulatory mechanisms through tight regulatory authorities approvals. So, these approvals are obtained only when you follow certain good manufacturing practices such as cleanliness or wearing of the, you know, as you can see the scarf, the lab coat, the, you know, shoe covers and gloves and all those things, and then this entire area should be sterilized again and again. And nowadays you definitely know corona virus is going on, so we anyway, you know, sterilize ourselves. But then these work cultures are to be maintained, and there are regulatory authorities who visit every now and then to make sure that these things are well taken into account. So, once you have set up all of those, then you go for the production, and this is the flow chart of production which is taken from your CBSE unit 5 book. And you can see, so you have a microbial source, let us say microbes or E. coli is growing here, that is the source from which organisms, from which the protein is going to be extracted. So, you have an E. coli source or a microbial source, and then you do a fermentation. This process which I have just now shown is called fermentation, because you know these organisms grow and then they produce a large amount, these grow and produce a large amount of components. So, those are the fermentation processes, and after the fermentation processes the protein can be obtained from two locations. It depends upon what kind of organism, where the protein is produced. I mentioned this earlier in my earlier classes also. So, protein can be present inside the cell, or protein can be thrown out of the cell. So, it depends upon the organism which produces the protein. It can be intracellular protein or extracellular protein. So, if it is an intracellular protein, then it adds to one more step of the protein production, that is those cells within which these proteins are being produced are to be broken, or the protein has to be recovered from these cells by disruption of the cells, and that disruption process is done by either homogenization or some other processes that I have shown you in my earlier classes. And then you go for centrifugation and the precipitation or the purification processes. However, it is if the protein is extracellularly produced, that is protein is not inside the cell, but the cell as it grows and it generates, produces the protein and throws it outside into the medium, then you need not have to actually rupture the cell or homogenize the cell or disrupt the cell as is shown in this step. Rather, you just remove the cells and the remaining medium actually has that protein of your interest, and then you go for the purification steps as is done in these cases. So, I will show you some quick snapshots so that you can have a quick idea of what all steps are used. So, if you have a cell, so this is let us say a cell, this is although looks like an animal cell, but let us assume that this is a cell where the proteins can be produced intracellularly, that is within the cell, this is the nucleus, and then or it can be secreted outside, that is all through in the medium. So, those cells are put into a medium, medium means the food nutrient in which, and along with supplements of oxygen and other pH and rest of the things. So, these cells grow in number 1 to 2, 2 to 4 and so on, and then they populate this culture, and once you do so, you can just centrifuge the cells down, you know, and then the cells can be, so you have these proteins, so you can actually homogenize, so you can actually break the cells or disrupt the cells either by chemical treatment or osmotic shock or even by using simple pressure as in case of French press or some other methods which I have already talked to you. So, once you break the cells, you know, it will consist of the cell debris and the proteins of your interest, which are shown here. Now, what you do is you centrifuge them again, so that the rest of the cell debris is just settling at the bottom and you have a clear liquid at the top, which is the protein of your interest. You go for different kinds of chromatographic techniques, whether it is ion exchange chromatography, affinity chromatography or size exclusion chromatography. Remember, I talked about each one of these separation or purification techniques in my last class vividly. You can actually go and visit that presentation, so you will have a very fair idea about how these things happen. So, if the protein is charged, let us say, you know, positively charged or negatively charged, let us say you have a negatively charged protein, you can actually have a column which is made up of positively charged beads, and the proteins would bind there because of charge-charge attraction, opposite charge attraction, and then you can elute these proteins separately. Or you can have affinity chromatography, where the protein of your interest has affinity or likeliness for a particular material, which is now fixed on the column sides in the form of beads. Then you pour the proteins out of the mixture, which are not of your concern, simply flows out because they do not have affinity to the column material, whereas those proteins which have affinity will bind, and you can elute them separately. So, that way you can purify. You can do so by gel filtration chromatography, where the separation of the proteins happens on the basis of their size. Depending on the bigger size material will come out first, and the smaller size and gradually smaller size materials will come out last, because these beads are made up of sponges. The interstices of the sponges are the ones in which the smaller size proteins enter, and that is why, you know, it results in the formation of slow release. So, once you have all these purification steps in process, then you can actually have a purified protein, which you can verify by running it on an SDS page, where you can ideally see. SDS page is SDS polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. In just two slides or three slides next, I will be talking to you about how that is done. So, you can see a single band representing a purified protein, and you can actually, that purified protein can be dried by various techniques. So, you can just evaporate the water, or what is called as freeze drying methods, you know, so you can cool and gradually with a vacuum take out all the water in the vapor phase. So, that way it will leave only the powdered form of protein. So, if you have the powdered form of protein, that is a solid form of protein, this powdered form can be stored for longer duration and you can keep using it as and when required. So, that is like a general broad way of steps or the workflow that goes on in production of large quantities of protein. So, you can do the freezing by freeze drying or some other methods. Now, you have the protein, which you know, just as a glimpse, I have shown you that it can be characterized by the presence of a single band. So, I will tell you, suppose you have a purified protein, now you have to characterize the protein before selling it off, saying that this is a pure protein. So, how do you characterize the protein? As I told you, one of the major techniques is electrophoretic techniques, and the first one in that series is the SDS page or SDS polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. Apart from that, you can actually, you know, detect the impurities by impurities, you can determine the mass, you can look at the charge, you can look at the amino acid sequence, and everything else you can determine by following certain techniques. So, let's look at the electrophoretic techniques, and the best one, as I said, is the SDS polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis, or in short it is called SDS page. So, SDS is sodium dodecyl sulfate, and what it does is, you know, suppose this is a polypeptide. So, it has these disulfides, and then there are all kinds of charges in the amino acids, as I have told you. So, this can be negatively charged like glutamic acid, aspartic acid, or positively charged like asparagine or glutamine or, you know, lysine, etcetera. And then there can be disulfide bonds between cysteine residues, cysteine amino acids. So, once the first you have this protein in this form, let us say in this form or this form, and then what you do is you add a little bit of beta mercaptoethanol or 2-mercaptoethanol. Mercaptoethanol is nothing but in ethanol, you know, C2H5OH. So the OH is replaced by SH. So that's what it becomes, mercaptoethanol. So you have two mercaptoethanol. You add this mercaptoethanol, what it does is, these are SS bonds or the disulfide bonds. The ethanol, mercaptoethanol SH bonds actually breaks these disulfide bonds between the protein molecules or within the protein molecules. And once it breaks, it becomes reduced to SH and SH. Therefore, this link is broken or these links are broken. Now, once the protein intramolecular disulfide bonds are broken, okay, this protein becomes much straighter. But then you have SDS. SDS, what it does is, SDS is sodium dodecyl sulfate. So what it does, it provides a uniform negative charge depending upon the length of the protein, because it binds to linear structure of polypeptide along the length by forming by interacting with the amide bonds. So you know, as you see, you add mercaptoethanol, you add SDS which has negative charge, and then you add all of them to this protein mixture and then simply boil it. What will happen is, these SS bonds will be broken to SH-SH and the negative charges will get loaded on the peptide bonds along the length. Now, depending on the length of the protein, that many will be the negative charge and so on. So these are like straight chain proteins. Now, if you put them together in a jelly like material and add some electrical voltage against the top and the lower part, that means here you have the negative end and you have the positive end on the other side, and then supply electricity, then what will happen is, these proteins will start migrating in the gel depending on their size. So bigger the size, they will be restricted more to migrate, and they will migrate to certain points after a certain point of time. But then smaller proteins at the same point of time will migrate faster and reach towards the end of the gel, and then those bands can easily be visualized as a pictorial diagram, pictorial presentation here is what is shown. So this process of addition of mercaptoethanol and SDS to the proteins and then boiling it is called denaturation of the proteins, because the protein, actually the folded structure is completely broken, and that process is called denatured protein. So this is denatured protein. You place all the proteins on gel and then move it according to, as I said, negative and positive electrodes. So the smaller proteins will migrate towards the end. The bigger proteins will have more restriction. They will go slow, and then they migrate to different positions from which you can easily figure out the size of the protein as well as look at the purity of the protein. The other electrophoretic techniques include isoelectric focusing and 2D gel electrophoresis. Both of these have been talked to you in my previous class, but I will re-emphasize that because these are very important protein characterization techniques. So the isoelectric focusing essentially gives you an idea of the charge of the protein, although nowadays we have a very good algorithm, very robust algorithms. You can just feed in the protein sequence in your computer database and then quickly get the tentative PI or the isoelectric point of the protein or the charge of the protein. So what is isoelectric point? Isoelectric point of a protein is the charge of the protein at which is the pH at which the charge on the surface of the protein becomes neutralized. So what happens is, in an isoelectric focusing, you have a gel, and then the gel has ampholytes. Ampholytes are small chemical substances with charges. So the ampholytes are loaded at one part of the gel and moved by application of electric voltage. So you have a positive and a negative. The positive is low pH and high, and the negative is high pH. And depending upon the charge on the small molecules or the ampholytes, they will start migrating and reach a position depending upon their charge neutral position. So here, for example, are the positively charged ampholytes which have reached this position. That means at this point the charge is now neutral on the surfaces and so on. So they form what is called as a gradient of charges. Now, within this gradient of charges, if you load a set of proteins, a mixture of proteins, and apply the electric voltage, those proteins will also migrate to the equivalent position where the charge matches the isoelectric point. That is how you get the charge on a protein or information of the charge on a protein. Now, once you have the information of charge on a protein, many a times it might happen that two or three proteins would have very similar or equivalent charges, and if it happens, then there will be no separation of those charges on the basis of this isoelectric focusing alone. However, if you just run this entire thing in the second dimension, that is once you run vertically from top to down and then place it, you know, just turn it around and place it on another gel and run it again, then each one of these bands are further separated into 2-3 bands on an SDS page. Now, here the first direction is depending on the charge and the second direction is depending on their molecular weight. As I just now told you in my previous slide how the SDS works, the smaller molecules will migrate faster, the larger one will migrate slower, and therefore, each one of these bands are further separated into number of bands and you can have a pure protein at any point. So, you not only get the information about the charge, you also get information about the composition of the proteins, you also get information about the size of the protein. So, all these things can be obtained and have still been obtained in many labs, which is a very, very common technology used in all kinds of laboratories. However, we have definitely, as you know, time progresses, we have much better technology now available, where you know many laboratories have what is called as before that I would like to tell you about the so you get information about charge, you get information about size, but then can you get information about what is the composition of this protein? So you have purified the protein, but now you need, here you have purified the protein, you have got the charge information, you have got the size information. Now can you get the information about the amino acid sequence? So earlier Sanger actually devised a method by which you can get the information about this amino acid. So, what he used was a dinitrophenyl benzene, which is shown here. So, you have dinitrophenyl benzene, and this dinitrophenyl benzene, you know, actually can react with this free amino terminal, amino group of the amino N-terminal amino acid of a polypeptide. So, you see CONH is a peptide bond, here again CONH is another peptide bond and a peptide bond. You have R dash and R double dash, which represents the amino acid, let us say this is glycine, valine, isoleucine and so on. So, you have this last one, which is the amino terminal or N terminal NH, the N has a pair of electron. Therefore, this dinitrophenyl benzene actually reacts with this N and forms and then it forms an intermediate. Now, this intermediate, if you actually provide a very harsh hydrolytic conditions means acidic conditions, then it actually helps in the formation of dinitrophenol derivative, which is an intermediate, and from this dinitrophenol derivative you can actually get the information of the first amino acid, that is this R. But what happens, this process actually gives you information about the particular amino acid, but because this had some some drawbacks, because you know this process involves a very harsh hydrolysis step, and this hydrolysis often would break not only this bond but also breaks subsequent peptide bonds or other bonds that would hamper the process, and you have to have pure protein again and again to do the next cycle of reaction. This problem, however, was mitigated to some extent by this Edmond degradation method, who actually used, rather than dinitrophenyl benzene, he used a phenyl isothiocyanate. So, this is a phenyl and then isothiocyanate. So, this is a thiocyanate group, and because so this also acted as a nucleophile for this set of electrons of the terminal amino group, and then that actually formed a thiozolinone derivative as is shown here, and this thiozolinone derivative undergoes can be subjected to a mild acidic condition. So, remember here you have a harsh hydrolysis condition, here you are providing a mild acidic condition, and that would result phenyl thiohydantoin molecule. Now, this phenyl thiohydantoin has this R group which can easily be recognized. And then this process can be repeated. So, now what you have is one amino acid short chain, and this next amino acid which was here is now capable of interacting with a new set of new phenyl isothiocyanate molecule, and then this amino acid or R dash can also be recognized. So, these are the processes where Edman degradation process where you know you can by repeated cycles actually get the information amino acid after amino acid starting from the N terminus. So, this was a very very useful technology and it has been used quite extensively in many laboratories of late. However, nowadays the protein sequencing and information technique all can be combined. The molecular weight determination all can be combined by a method called mass spectrometry. And there are various ways of determining mass or molecular weight of a protein. One of them I am just representing here, which is called the MALDI technique or MALDI-TOF technique, which is matrix assisted laser desorption ionization. So, MALDI, MALDI TOF, TOF is time of flight technique. So, you can have a mass spectrometric technique. One of the technique is called MALDI TOF technique, and I will tell you what this MALDI TOF technique involves. So, what is a mass spectrometer? It is an analytical device that determines the molecular weight of chemical compounds by separating molecular ions according to their mass to charge ratio. So, this mass to charge ratio is automatically being generated because you generate the charge on these molecules by a method which I will be telling you in just few minutes. So, the molecular ions which I just now told you which are getting separated on a mass spec are generated by loss or gain of charge. That is either by electron ejection or protonation, that is addition of H plus, or deprotonation or removal of H plus. How are these electron ejection or protonation is brought about? That I will tell you in a second. So, after the ions are formed, they can be separated according to their mass by charge ratio, M by Z ratio, and finally, they can be detected. The process of ionization. So, how do you get these ions, molecular ions? It is by ionization, and then ion separation, that is you, once you ionize by removing the electron or addition of electron or protonation and deprotonation, those ions are separated and detection in a mass spectrometer or mass spectrum which can provide molecular weight or even structural information. So, a sample M with a molecular weight greater than let us say 1200 Dalton, D is Dalton, can give rise to multiple charged ions, so that the charged ions, the multiple states are M plus NH with N number of charges. N is the number of charged charges that one can that a mass particular mass can gain. I will give you that example in a second. But the proteins and peptides which is of interest to us at this point of time may have suitable sites for protonation. What are the sites? So, these are the sites. So, all the backbone amide nitrogen atoms. So, for example, this is an amide nitrogen, the backbone of this amide nitrogen is capable of undergoing. So, this nitrogen is capable of undergoing protonation, deprotonation, all these things. So, here it can be protonated, here O can be protonated, N can be protonated and so on. So, amide nitrogen atoms could be protonated theoretically as well as certain amino acid side chains such as lysine and arginine which has amino group and primary amine group as a functional group, they can also be protonated. So, once they are protonated, they becomes more charged, and once they are more charged, the mass by charge ratio will provide you the detection possibility. So, here is how we do the experiment or get the mass. So, what happens is you have a plate which consists of these small wells. So, this is ideally made up of stainless steel or non-corrosive material, and then these small you know holes here right here can be loaded with proteins. So, protein as small amount as a few micromolar concentration can be used, and then to that you add. So, for example, you have isolated the proteins from this sample, let us say a culture, bacterial culture, and here is the final protein. You take this protein and add it to this well, but in this well you also add something called a matrix. What is this matrix? Synapinic acid or alpha cyano are the matrices, typical matrices, and if you mix that with this protein solution then and then dry it, it immediately dries and forms a solid mass, and that solid mass is now present now put in a big instrument like this. I am not showing the instrument, this is only a cartoon to represent how the mass gets determined. So, here is the plate and then consists of these dots. Each one of these dots are actually representing protein along with a matrix. Now, so protein is embedded in the matrix, and then what you do is you hit it, each one of these spots, hit these spots with the help of a laser. Now, what does this laser do? This laser actually helps in desorption. So, you know what, you know something called adsorption. So, adsorption is actually sitting on the surface or settling on the surface, it just gets adsorbed, it just gets sitting on the surface. Desorption is just the opposite of that, that is it just flows out or goes out of the surface. How does it go out of the surface? After hitting up this laser, what happens is it forms a plume of ions and that goes off the surface, and then as soon as that happens there is a voltage difference between this plate and a channel which is placed here. These are the electrodes. So, this channel actually pulls all the plume of ions to flow past, because this is kept at a very high voltage. So, they just flow past or move towards these electrodes, and once they move towards these electrodes there is an orifice at the center of the electrode which allows the ions which are accelerated to pass through this channel, and then depending upon their charge, mass by charge, they will start flowing all the way through this huge flight tube to the end and falls on a detector. Now, imagine if we have 3 or 4 people, one is a heavy guy, the others are lighter and lighter and lighter and so on, and they are asked to start from one point and asked to start running towards the other point. Okay. Gradually, as the time of this running end increases, that is the distance from the start point to the end point increases, a fat guy or a big guy or a large molecule would gradually slow down or will not reach the end as fast as the smallest guy. So, depending on the mass by charge ratio, they will actually start flowing towards the other end, and then this detector would detect the ions that are reaching there, and the first one that reaches will be of the lowest molecular weight, followed by the next one and next one. So, this simple technology actually gives you intensity profiles on an m by z x axis, mass by charge axis, and then you get the information about the molecular weight. So, this is how a mass spectrometry or matrix assisted mass spectrometry, laser desorption ionization mass spectrometry works. There are other methods of ionization. Here laser is used, somewhere else electrons, spray of electrons are used, somewhere else some other technology of ionization is used, and all of them essentially defines the charge by mass by charge ratio, and then depending upon the molecular weight depending upon the size of the molecule, each one of those charges will reach the detector at different times, and depending upon these different times they detect the mass. Here is a representative taken from the CBSE unit 5 book. In figure 11, you can see the relative intensity for the same protein with a molecular weight of 10,000 may contain 5 charges. So, as I said, m plus 5h, 5 protonations. It can have 4 protonation m plus 4h, or 3 protonation, 2 protonation, or 1 protonation. So, it can have 5 positive charge or 4 positive charge, 3, 2, 1 positive charges, and then each one of them the mass spectrometer detects the protein ions at m by z, which is 2001, or 2501 or 3334. So you see each one of them is divided by 2 is 3334, this is 5001, this is 10,000. So a molecular weight of 10,000 will give you very close by, you know, peaks of this, and the 10,000 will be, you know, the maximum one, and these will be very close by. So it will look like, you know, some small spikes. Each one of these spikes actually represent the different charged ions of the same molecule, whereas the 10,000 one will be the one which will just, you know, give you the peak, the maximum one, and then there will be distribution. So this one represents a 10,000 molecular weight compound. Moving on, now that we have learned how to determine, how to actually get information about the protein, how to know about the qualities of the protein, that is the molecular weight, its charge, and several other parameters, even the amino acid composition. Now we will move on to actually calculating some of the components that are required before you proceed for any large scale or even small scale protein purification. So this question is taken from your book, which is: an E. coli cell produces at least 2000 different proteins. So let us say we have this E. coli cell, and then these are the different proteins, so A, B, C, D, all different colors are shown. One of these is our enzyme, let us say the green one is our enzyme or the enzyme of your interest which you want to purify, and is produced at levels of 3000 molecules per cell under optimum condition. That is, if you take one cell, there will be 3000 molecules. If you take two cells, there will be 6000 molecules. If you take 10 cells, there will be 30,000 molecules. If you take 1 lakh cells, there will be as many number of molecules under optimum conditions. And you remember, each one of these cells when put into a medium as a flask would consist of millions of cells. So the condition, if we have to purify 1 gram of this intracellular enzyme, what is this intracellular enzyme? This enzyme, that is the green colored component, out of all these components, if we want to purify 1 gram, so the question is, estimate how many cells of bacteria will be required theoretically. What is given is, it is given that the molecular weight of the enzyme of interest is 1 lakh gram, that is the molecular weight. So what is given? That there are 3000 molecules in one cell, and each one of these green component or a protein is molecular weight of 1 lakh gram, that is the molecular weight. Therefore, 1 lakh gram of protein or enzyme of interest corresponds to, because this is a gram molecular weight, so it corresponds to 1 mole of the enzyme, right? We know gram molecular weight is equal to 1 mole. And what is 1 mole? 1 mole is 6.023 into 10 to the power 23, that is the Avogadro number of molecules, that is the Avogadro's number. So we have 1 lakh gram of protein would contain 6.023 into 10 to the power 23 molecules. Hence, 1 gram of the enzyme would be, so this is 1 lakh gram, therefore 1 gram, we have to purify 1 gram, so 1 gram of the enzyme has 1 by 1 lakh into 6.023 into 10 to the power 23, that is, you know, you just take off these 5, so it goes to 6.023 into 10 to the power 18 molecules. So these many molecules would be there in 1 gram of this protein. Now the question already given that there are 3000 molecules present in one cell, therefore how many cells would be required for, so one cell has 3000, okay. How many of these molecules will be, how many of the cells will be required to have these many molecules? That is very simple, you know, calculation. So you just calculated, it comes to 2 into 10 to the power 15 cells. That is a huge number of cells. So that is the kind of, you know, culture that you have to grow to actually get 1 gram of protein. So you see, this is a simple calculation, and you can actually have how many cells required. Now let us proceed to another one. Remember, you know, these cells grow by the duplication process, that is 1 forms 2, 2 goes for So geometric progression, 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 4, 4 goes to 8, you know, and so on. So within like, you know, few hours, you will have 10 to the power 15 cells from one cell. So that is the time period you can also calculate, etc. Actually, people do not go by the time period. What they do is they decide depending upon the OD or optical density of the cells. So, for example, you take a little bit of this culture which is grown in those flasks which I showed you earlier, and take a little bit and put it under a tube and put it in a spectrophotometer. The spectrophotometer would give you an indication of the OD of the optical density. And then depending on that OD, you calculate back how many cells are there. More the OD, more is the number of cells. OD is measured at 600 nanometer. Let us move ahead with another question, which is related to this question, but slightly different than this one, and you can get an information of that. So here, assuming that the bacterial cell is a cylinder, although in the previous diagram I showed you that the bacterial cell looks like a sphere, which is not correct. Bacteria E. coli cells actually looks more like a cylinder. And let us assume that the diameter of the cylinder is 1 micrometer and the height of the diameter is 1 micrometer and the height of the cylinder is 2 micrometer. So there are two calculations that request to be done. One, the total packed cell volume of E. coli required to produce 1 gram of intracellular enzyme. So it is related to the previous question. There also we were required to find out how many cells would be required to produce 1 gram. Here the question has been changed. What is the total packed cell volume? So we have now the number of cells, that is already known. Now what is the volume, packed volume of the cells? That is what they want to know. And the second is the volume of the fermenter. So as I told you, we can go from a flask to a laboratory scale fermenter to a big huge fermenter. So the volume, so they are not only asking the packed, the dense cell volume, but also the volume of the fermenter that will be required if the maximum cell concentration in the fermenter is 5%. You see, you cannot actually have this entire volume of cells packed with entire volume of this fermenter packed with cells. But if that happens, then the cells have no space to grow, there is no aeration, there is no movement, there nothing can happen, and therefore the cells will automatically start dying. So what you need to do in these cases is the fermenters not only requires a lot of breathing space, lot of air space, but also requires a lot of other spaces for the bacteria to grow. So this space is the head space, and this head space, as is said, is only 5% required. So let us now start calculating. What is given? The diameter is given, 1 micrometer, that is 10 to the power minus 6 meter. And if the diameter is 1 into 10 to the power 6 meter, what is the radius? Radius is, you are right, the radius is 0.5 into 10 to the power 6, 10 to the power minus 6 meter. What is the height? 2 micrometer. So 2 into 10 to the power minus 6 meter. As I said, here we are assuming that the bacterial cell is a cylinder. So what is the volume of a cylinder? Volume of a cylinder is given by pi r square h. As you can see, you have a pi r square h. So you put those values, pi into r, that is pi r square into h, and then you get this information, which is 1.57 into 10 to the power minus 18 meter cube. So that is the volume of one bacterial cell. How many cells are required? In the previous example, this one, we just calculated that we need 2.007 into 10 to the power 15 cells. So taking that number, the volume of 2 into 10 to the power 15 cells would be, what would be the volume? This multiplied by that, and if you do so, it is 3.15 into 10 to the power minus 3 meter cube. And since 10 to the power minus 3 meter cube is 1 liter, therefore, you have 3.15 liter, that is the packed volume of cells that are required. But that packed volume is for the entire number of just cells, but as I say, as is mentioned here, the fermenter concentration requires to be only 5% of the total space available. Therefore, 5% concentration will be 1/5 of 3.15, 100 by 5, that is the percentage calculation. 100 by 5 into 3.15 is only 65 liters. So, the volume of fermenter required would be at least more than 63 liters, which is about 82 liters, because the fermenter would require about 30% head space. So, these are the some of the calculations that people do when they actually go for large scale production of proteins. So, these calculations will help you to decide the size of the fermenter, the size of the culture, the number of cells that are required, the number of proteins that can be produced, the quantity of the protein that can be produced, the purity of the protein can be determined, the mass of the protein can be analyzed, and various all these parameters, as I have been talking to you, gradually can be obtained by doing some simple calculations and some analytical technologies. I will now move on to the downstream. So, now you have the protein in hand. Now, you have to purify the protein, and I have actually emphasized on these processes time and again. So, it depends upon the source material, and that will, so that the processes of purification of the protein after the cells produce the protein is called the downstream processing. So, the source material chosen will dictate the range and type of contaminants present in the starting material. So, if you are isolating from bacteria, obviously there will be bacterial components, and then the media will have its own components that will contaminate your protein of interest. If you choose an animal cell, that will have its own components, and those will be the contaminants, and so on. So, if the protein is extracellular, then you need to separate the cellular components. If it is intracellular, you not only need to remove the cellular components, you need to actually disrupt the cells by using sonication or French press, and then that will have its own types of contaminants. So, plant and fungal cells require harsher breakage methods, because plant cells have, apart from the cell membrane, you already know, consists of a cell wall, you know, whereas animal cells are easier to break because they do not have a cell wall. Bacterial cells, however, require very small, bacterial cells being very small require very high pressure techniques like the French press or the sonication. So, depending upon what is the source material, where is the protein that you wish to actually take out, where the protein, whether it is intracellular or extracellular, your processes or the downstream processes varies. Now, I will show you again a flow chart of one particular protein as taken as an example to how the process, you know, is followed. So, here is a flask which is shown, and then this flask consists of the bacteria which is growing as geometric progression, as I told you. So, that is the E. coli. One of these cells is pictorially represented here. This is a bacterial cell. Let us assume this is a cylinder more or less, and it consists of a protein of your interest which is shown as target protein. And this target protein, somehow you have made this target protein to have certain tags. What are these tags? These are genetically manipulated tags which are utilized for purification of the protein in the later downstream processes. So, in this particular case, the target protein has been linked with histidines. If you remember one of my previous classes, I told you that this histidine is a very useful amino acid, because this histidine has a capability to bind to nickel. So, if you have a column consisting of nickel ions, the histidine can go and actually cling onto it. Therefore, all the other components, for example, the proteins like E1, E2, E3, these are just representative proteins which are contaminants. So, as soon as you break this E. coli cell, all these proteins like E1, E2, E3, as well as your target protein, will come into the solution. But you have to only purify this target protein and get rid of the E1, E2, E3 components. So, in the process to do so, what you do is you genetically manipulate in such a fashion in the E. coli that the target protein is already tagged with a histidine, with 6 histidines, so that it can bind to a column containing nickel, whereas others E1, E2, E3 cannot bind. And you have another tag that is attached towards the other end of the protein called the MBP or the maltose binding protein. So, this is a separate tag. So, you can have a histidine tag, you can have a maltose binding tag, you can have any number of tags towards the attached to the N terminus or the C terminus of the protein. And then these tags can be utilized for purification of the protein by affinity chromatography. Please go and have a look at the affinity chromatography session that I told you in my last class. So, once you have this protein which is the target protein which is tagged along with many other proteins, you centrifuge this culture so that the cells only are at the bottom. You take those and lyse the cells. Lyse means you add some lysis buffer. Lysis means breaking up the cells. You add some lysis buffer and do a homogenization or sonication as is shown in this particular diagram. So, you break the cells. Now, the cells are broken, all the components inside the cell are out, and then you centrifuge it down again. So, the cell debris, every other thing, every other component of the cell, whether it is lipids, whether it is membranous components, whether it is other compartments of the cell, everything is settling down. You have those settled components, and then you can go for one step of purification, the very first step of purification, which is called the salting out effect. I told this one also in my previous class. So, what happens is the proteins, these proteins, whether E1, E2, E3 or target proteins, they remain soluble in the solvent, whatever solvent you are using, the buffer that you are using. So, this buffer will consist of some ions. Now, if you keep on increasing the concentration of salt into that buffer, the water molecules that were earlier interacting with the protein molecules would now be scavenged away from the protein molecules, and they will start, you know, going towards the ions. So, the salt will get more of these water molecules, and therefore, once you take away the water molecules from the protein will precipitate. So, that is one form or the first form of purification of the protein. You can do the protein precipitation by actually increasing or decreasing the pH of the buffer. As I told you in the previous slide or previous to previous slide, talking about the isoelectric focusing gel, there you can get the charge on the surface of a protein. If you actually know the charge or pi of the protein, you can actually bring the pH of the solution equivalent to the pi of the protein, and if these two matches, then the protein will precipitate, because simply all the charges on the surface of the protein are neutralized at a particular pH which is equivalent to its pi. If it does so, then the protein having no charge would not interact with anything else, but it will simply succumb out of the solution. Then you can go for all different steps of chromatographic purification, for example, size exclusion chromatography. So you can go for affinity columns. For example, here you have a histidine tag, so you can go for a nickel mediated purification. You can use the maltose binding protein tag and so on. So, you go for, so this NTA is nickel NTA resin, so through which you can purify the protein. Then you can dialyze the protein. You can remove the tag, so you can just cut out these tags from here by using some proteases, and then you finally concentrate and then go for size exclusion chromatography. Each one of these techniques are taught to you in greater details. So, what happens in the process is that you actually go on increasing the specific activity of the protein, which is the active protein units per milligram of the mass that you get. So, if you go on step by step, what happens is in the crude extract, that is somewhere here after the lysis, that is called the crude extract, you have, let us say, all the different proteins E1, E2, E3 and as well as your target. So, let us say the total protein is 20,000 milligrams, but the activity in that protein is about 40,000 units, but the specific activity, that is units per mg. So, what is the unit? 40,000 divided by 20,000. So, you have about 200 units. 4 lakh divided by 20,000, that is about 200 units. You go for the precipitation cycle, that is, you know, this step of purification, and then many proteins get precipitated. So, you probably get, let us say, assume that you have a total protein after this step about 5000 milligrams, and you have activity which is 3 lakh units. So, you have increased the specific activity to 600. If you go on another step of purification, for example, pH or salt based, pH based precipitation, you have total unit, total protein is decreasing as you can see. So, 20,000 milligram to 1000 milligram, but the activity is keep on, you know, activity is also decreasing, but the specific activity, that is unit per mg, keeps on increasing. And finally, after the size exclusion chromatography, you have very small amount of protein, let us say 45 milligrams only, but the specific activity, all the proteins that are there are active, because here you have lot of contaminants which are not active, here you have all the contaminants removed which is very, very active. So, in the case of you know, we can concentrate this protein very easily, and the concentration can be determined by absorption at 280 nanometer, a process that has been taught to you in some other class. So, just to, you know, re-emphasize on some of these steps in the processes, there are some intermediate steps. Here it is just a, you know, flow diagram, but then there are some intermediate steps which depends upon. So, for example, if you have a crude cell homogenate, that is somewhere here after the sonication. So, you have a crude cell homogenate, it is more many times added to dextran and polyethylene glycol mixture. So, here is a dextran polyethylene glycol mixture. You have these are the crude extract that is obtained after the sonication cycle. So, before you pellet down, you can do this. So, you have the all the components of the crude extract, and then you add polyethylene glycol PEG plus dextran into that, mix it thoroughly, and then centrifuge it very heavily. Once you do so, you will find a phase separation. The polyethylene glycol phase would consist, that is the liquid phase, that is the organic phase, would consist of the proteins, whereas the more polar dense phase, that is that more polar dense phase would actually consist of all the, you know, the cellular debris which you do not need. Here the protein will be in this polyethylene glycol phase. So, after this you can just separate this phase out, that is the polyethylene glycol phase out in a separate tube, and then, you know, if this consists of some nucleic acid, then you can add nuclease. Nuclease, as the name suggests, is attached to the name, suggests that nucleic acids can be broken, can be fragmented and so on, and then you can pass it on to another you know, tube, so that after the nuclease you can precipitate it out and take out the supernatant, which consists of only proteins and no nucleases. If however, your homogenate consists of not only the exosomes, but also some lipid components, for example, the membranes that are also there, you can pass it through a glass wool containing membrane mesh in this process. So, this is a glass wool membrane, and this glass wool membrane can be fitted to a tube. There is a hole at the bottom of the tube, and if you have the membranous components in this exosome, in this homogenate, then entire thing can be poured in here, and then this can be placed in here and centrifuged, so that every component here actually passes through this glass wool membrane. If it passes through, then glass wool has the capacity to actually adhere the lipid contaminants, and those contaminants will be separated. Therefore, you can have a clear solution in this tube. Followed by that, you can do the normal, you know, ion exchange or affinity chromatography, as has been suggested in the previous section. So, these are two additional steps which may be required in the process of flow of, you know, the downstream processing of purification of your proteins, depending on whether it has large number of lipid contaminants or large number of nucleic acid contaminants, or you need to actually get rid of many of the cellular debris or exosomes, then you can actually go for a polyethylene glycol dextran based separation at this step. So, with that, I am almost reaching towards the end of this class, but before I end, I would like to tell you some of the efforts that are required to maintain stability of the protein during the purification. So, what happens is, many a times, because as I have been telling you, there are so many steps for finally getting a purified protein, and many of these steps may go awry, you may actually end up increasing the temperature of the protein. The time required for these steps would be much higher. In the process, the protein which was present inside the cell might undergo denaturation, degradation, etc. So, those are the processes that has to be taken care very carefully. There are many more steps. The steps depends upon what kind of protein is it, what is the purity level that is required, what is the final end usage of that protein, whether it is going to be injected into a human being for a pharmaceutical purpose. Then those things has to be very, very tightly regulated and they has to be very, very pure. But in these purification processes, the protein undergoes very harsh treatments many a times. For example, when you sonicate, the proteins may get denatured. When you actually add some acid or some other components, they may get denatured and become inactive. So, you have to maintain the activity of the protein at every step, and for that certain methods have been proposed. What are those methods? I will tell you that. So, the buffering component. So, it is important that during extraction, proteins are provided with well buffered environment so that they can cope up with sudden changes in pH. As I just now suggested, that you can actually in the processes of protein purification requires either addition of too much of salt or addition of or changing of the pH. Sudden changes in the pH would actually hamper the protein's activity, because as it is cushioned and is present inside a cell where the pH is more or less ideal around 6 to 7 or 7.5. But as soon as you take it out, then it is exposed to various kinds of pH and harsh conditions as well as salt. So, you need to have these proteins in a buffered solution so that it does not, it can cope up with quick changes or sudden changes in pH. That would extend the stability or life of protein. Number two is temperature at which the extraction is carried out. Ideally, most of the proteins that are required by us are produced from organisms that grow and they are active around 37 degrees centigrade. So, the proteins that are produced in those or obtained from those organisms are also stable and active at 37 degrees centigrade. If you increase the temperature in the process of sonication or any other steps to higher than 40-45 degrees centigrade, many a times these proteins will get denatured. It is always ideal to actually have a temperature lower than this particular 37 degree centigrade. So, ideally the processes are done at, let us say, 25 degree centigrade, and wherever there is a storage required. So, wherever you have some certain steps done and at the end of the day you want to go home, you put the protein or that step purified protein into the freezer either at 4 degree centigrade. But if you wish to actually keep it for longer duration, you can keep it at minus 20 degree centigrade. So, storage at minus 20 degree centigrade, just keeping for few hours 4 degree centigrade or on ice, and every step should ideally be performed on ice. 37 degree centigrade, 25 degree centigrade is the temperature of the laboratory most of the time. So, you maintain that temperature where most of the proteins are found to be okay. However, if you increase the temperature in any of these one of these steps about 37 degree centigrade, it is potentially dangerous, the protein may lose its activity. The third is inclusion of additives in extraction. Many a times, even after purification of the protein and keeping it under buffer and also the particular temperature, let us say 4 degree or 25 degree, still the protein actually undergoes various kinds of changes because it is not its natural environment. So, what you do is you can actually add some salt, some osmolytes, some of the reducing agents or inhibitors of proteases so that the protein remains stable. So, salt, osmolyte, reducing agents actually help in mitigating the rest of the components that were being added or also likely to be added or getting contaminated from the air or everywhere around. Because you are working in a laboratory setup, it is quite possible that you are working on different proteases. So, it might just, you know, through aerosol or some other component can actually enter your protein preparation and inhibit. There may be some other components which are not suitable for the protein to make it remain in solution. Therefore, you add additives like glycerol, osmolytes and so on. Then the process has to be, you have to avoid physical and chemical shock. So, I just now told you that during the steps you have the harsh sonication process, homogenization and also some centrifuge and pH addition and so on. So, these physical and chemical shocks has to be minimized as much as possible. And you know, do not just shake it too much, it will be frothing and you may lose many other qualities of the protein. And the lastly, all these steps, all these processes should be done at the minimum time possible. Because if you increase, if you increase the time, you know, so you can do the processes slowly or increase the number of steps so that you get a very, very purified product. But by the end of it, you might get a very high specific activity, but the amount of product will be very, very low, few milligrams. So, entire process of growing in thousands of liters has actually resulted in protein purification, in the purified protein product, which is just few milligrams or grams, which is not a desirable thing. So, ideally, do it in a pilot scale and try to minimize the number of steps so that you can minimize the time. Try to, you know, use some smart techniques. You need not have to go through all the steps that has been presented in the flow diagram. You can actually select one or two steps or avoid one or two steps, and you can actually, you know, do some trial and error. So, every protein is different. Every protein is a different animal. Every protein has its own PI, amino acid composition, pH, buffer, and every other component. So, each one of these steps need not have to be followed what has been said here. It depends upon the protein and the end product, the usage of the end product. So, depending on that, you have to optimize the set of steps that you wish to do to have a purified protein, and that is where you can minimize time. So, with that, I would thank you once again to remain attentive. I sincerely thank again all those who have been helpful in contributing on the web, from which I have taken these pictures, diagrams, data, information, and I very, very humbly thank them for providing this, which has been used for teaching and education purposes alone. Thank you very much.